My name is Christine Vesley, and I'm serving as your liturgist today. Thanks to our fabulous tech team, our entire service today is pre-recorded. But remember that we're all watching together, and you can enter comments in the chat window during the service. You should have found the bulletin link, but if not, please visit www.pilgrimoakpark.org/Sundays Online and click on the lovely blue button. And remember that you can join us for virtual coffee hour after the service concludes today. Welcome to all. Pilgrim is an arms open wide community eager to share our love of God and love of humanity with each and every one of you. Some of you we already know, and some of you are friends we have not met yet. It's been quite a week. All around us, life looks and feels strange and unsettling. More and more people are sick with COVID-19 and even dying from it. Our medical facilities and personnel are stretched thin. Our public spaces are no longer public spaces. Many are losing their jobs, and our homes have become our refuge and fortress against the disease, yet they are also comfy and familiar prison that we're coming to resent. Many of us are sad and weary. Yet, there are so many stories that show the generosity and sheer goodness of people. Have you heard of the siblings in Evanston who are using their restaurant, Jennifer's Edibles, to make meals for homebound seniors? Or Invisible Hands, an ad hoc network of Gen Zers in New York who run errands for their neighbors? There are stories like this every single day. So take heart, friends. Like Reverend Tim told us last week, God is doing something new among us. Trust that the arc of time bends to God's favor, and our abundant blessings of His love and His Son Jesus will sustain us through these trying days. We are, after all, His beloved children. Now please join me in our responsive call to worship printed in your bulletin. When we can't be in the same room together, touch us with your love, O God of life. When we must be 6 feet apart, touch us with your love, O God of life. When we aren't even supposed to touch our own faces, touch us with your love, O God of life. Help us to feel your presence. Touch us with your love, O God of life.
Please join me in an attitude of prayer. God of life, present and promised, you are the one to whom we call, for you are the one who hears, and you are the one who acts, bringing us new life with your grace and love and power. When we see nothing but hopelessness, you surprise us with the breath of your Spirit. Lead us in our time of worship that we may be prepared to follow your lead in places where life is at risk, places where hope seems far away, places where dreams die during sleep. Help us to face the future unafraid, trusting in your loving care and presence with us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'd like to invite everyone at home to please join me in singing the following hymn, "In the Bulb There Is a Flower," and we'll sing verses 1, 2, and 3.
Thank you.
to come to our God with the fullness of our lives, to admit our love and our hate, to admit our faith and our fear. Trusting in God's mercy, let us make our confession. Revitalizing God, your power goes far beyond our own, and yet still we act as though the pains of this world have final claim upon us. We give in to the despair and hopelessness of fear, not trusting in your ability to do what seems impossible to us. Forgive us for doubting your power to raise up new life in the midst of all the deaths we experience. Forgive us for wanting to limit you to the last day or the world beyond this one, not trusting you to move and act among us, within us, through us. Forgive us in our eyes to the wonder, open our eyes to the wonder of new life sprouting into being in our very midst. We ask for your help. We ask for your healing. We ask that you make us whole through the love of Jesus. Hear now our silent prayer. Even though the future is clouded, God is with us, guiding, healing, comforting, restoring. The peace of Christ surpasses our understanding. Receive it, celebrate it, and live into it with joy. Peace be with you.
Grove, wishing you peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
In every wilderness, God has seen us.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Je vous souhaite la paix.
Wir ønsker fred.
Watson and Debbie and Bill say
peace be with you.
May the peace of Christ be with you. From Leslie and Gus the dog to all my pilgrim friends and family.
God is guiding us. God is with us here.
Good morning and welcome. I call all the youth of the congregation forward. This morning we're going to be talking about waking up. Are you someone who wakes up easily, or is it hard for you to wake up? I hear some of you saying that it's not so easy for you to wake up. Maybe you need an alarm clock that might sound like this. Or maybe you'd like something a little more gentle, like the sound of birds chirping. Can I hear you make some bird chirping sounds at home? That was awesome. Thanks for doing that. But maybe if you're not someone who wakes up with the alarm clock or the bird chirping, maybe you need something a little more dramatic, like this. Well, that would certainly wake me up. But would it be loud enough to wake up the dead? I don't think so. But in our story today, Jesus wakes up his good friend from the dead with the sound of his voice. Now, Jesus had been traveling around, and his friends, Mary and Martha, whose brother Lazarus was a very good friend of Jesus, became very ill, and they sent message that they needed him. But he wasn't able to get there for 4 days, and by then, Lazarus had died. In fact, they had wrapped him up in the special clothing and had put him into the tomb. Now, Jesus went over to the tomb, asked them to roll away the rock, and called out, "Lazarus, come out." Let's try that all together. Are you ready? "Lazarus, come out. And just like that, Lazarus stood up and came out. Now, another amazing miracle that was done with the help of God. Now, we wouldn't be able to wake anyone up from the dead. But what do we learn from this message today? We learn that nothing is impossible with God. As long as we know God, walk with God, love God, and listen to God, all things are possible. Amen.
man named Lazarus was sick. He lived in Bethany with his sisters, Mary and Martha. This is the Mary who later poured the expensive perfume on the Lord's feet and wiped them off with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was sick. So the two sisters sent a message to Jesus, telling him,
Lord, your dear friend is very sick.
Lazarus' sickness will not end in death. No, it happened for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may take glory from this.
But when Jesus heard about it, he said,
let's go back to Judea.
But his disciples objected.
Rabbi, only a few days ago, the people in Judea were trying to stone you. Are you going there again?
There are 12 hours of daylight every day. During the day, people can walk safely. They can see because they have light of this world. But at night, there is danger of stumbling because they have no light. My friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but now I will go wake him up.
Lord, if he is sleeping, he will soon get better.
The disciples thought Jesus meant Lazarus was simply sleeping, but Jesus meant Lazarus had died. So he told them plainly,
Lazarus is dead, and for your sakes, I am glad I wasn't there. For now you will really believe. Come, let's go see him.
When Jesus arrived at Bethany, he was told that Lazarus had already been in his grave for 4 days. Bethany was only a few miles down the road from Jerusalem, and many of the people had come to console Martha and Mary in their loss. When Martha got word that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed in the house. Martha said to Jesus,
Lord, if only you had been there, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask.
Your brother will rise again.
Yes, he will rise when everyone else rises at the last day.
I am the resurrection of the life. Anyone who believes in me will live, even after dying. Everyone who lives in me and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this, Martha?
Yes, Lord. I have always believed you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one who has come into the world from God.
Then she returned to Mary. She called Mary aside from the mourners and told her,
the teacher is here and wants to see you.
So Mary immediately went to him. Jesus had stayed outside the village, at the place where Martha was to meet him. When the people who were at the house consoling Mary saw her leave so hastily, they assumed that she was going to Lazarus's grave to weep. So they followed her there. When Mary arrived and saw Jesus, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, if you had only been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping and saw the other people wailing with her, a deep anger welled up within him, and he was deeply troubled.
Where have you put him?
They told him, Lord, come and see. Then Jesus wept. The people who were standing nearby said, see how much he loved him? But some said, this man healed blind men. Couldn't he have kept Lazarus from dying? Jesus was still angry as he arrived at the tomb, a cave with a stone rolled across its entrance.
Roll the stone aside.
But Martha, the dead man's sister, protested.
Lord, he has been dead for 4 days. The smell will be terrible.
Didn't I tell you that you would see God's glory if you believe?
So they rolled the stone aside. Then Jesus looked up to heaven and said,
Father, thank you for hearing me. You always hear me, but I said it out loud for the sake of these people standing here, so that they will believe you sent me.
Then Jesus shouted,
Lazarus, come out.
And the dead man came out, his hands and feet bound in grave clothes, his face wrapped in a headcloth.
Unwrap him and let him go.
Many of the people who were with Mary believed in Jesus when they saw this happen. The word of God for the people of God.
We are so near to Jerusalem, and Calvary and the cross. In fact, the text says we are 2 miles away in this place of death and mourning at the grave, and with those who gather nearby, troubled in spirit, the family and friends of Lazarus, including Jesus. And we are, in church time, only 2 weeks away from the empty tomb. In the Gospel of John, this story of the raising of Lazarus is more than just a nice little story of friendship or yet another amazing miracle. It functions as a sign story. Its primary function is to reveal God and God's love for all the world, a love that goes over and above what could be expected, hoped for, or even imagined to be possible. Now, many Christians today profess a faith that assumes divine compassion, love, and even vulnerability. But that is not true for all. And it certainly hasn't been true in the long and diverse history of our tradition. God has often been imagined as distant and impassive, angry and punitive, powerfully frightening. The whole of the Gospel of John seeks to change this perception of God and invite us to believe and seek comfort in the love of a God who loves us so much that they would assume human form and dwell among us in the person of Jesus. The embodiment of God's love, agent of healing, justice, and transformation, giver of light and eternal life. As one of my confirmands once noted, the God of the New Testament seems a whole lot nicer than the one of the Old Testament, and I like this God better. At the heart of our gospel scripture for today lies the miracle of life given, and at the heart of the miracle lies an invitation to believe that Jesus is sent from God. But before we get to those questions, I imagine that some of us may be stuck on the question of whether or not we can really believe that a story like Lazarus being brought back to life could even have happened. For some of us, it's simply impossible to accept that the supernatural can overlap with the natural, that anything can occur for which there is no rational explanation. Even when we are eyewitnesses to events that others around us describe as miraculous, it's always a matter of reason over belief, of the known over the might be. Now, for others of us, the experiences of our lives have led us to accept that there is genuine mystery in the universe, that the world is full of evidence that the line between the supernatural and the natural is permeable, that there are forces that surpass the limits of our human understanding, meaning that the seemingly impossible could indeed be possible, creating room for both what is and what could be. And of course, there are many of us in between. And sometimes we might shift between these two perspectives depending on the season of our lives or the situation. Now, there's no way to prove the facts of the miracle of raising Lazarus from the dead. And in a way, that is fundamental to what the gospel writer is inviting us to wrestle with. Can we believe that God, acting through Jesus, has power over the course of life and death? Or stated more broadly, can we acknowledge the possibility of God's miraculous intervention in creation? It's a question of faith, and it's not necessarily an easy one. As we see in today's story, even those who had a close, loving, in-person relationship with Jesus and had experience with his previous miraculous acts had reasonable doubts about his power to interfere with the laws of nature. Both Mary and Martha believe that if Jesus had come immediately when they called, their brother would not have died. Jesus could have cured Lazarus' illness as he had healed so many others. But Jesus didn't come right away, And so Lazarus died. He'd been dead so long that mourners had become to gather. And given the lack of embalming, his body has naturally begun to decompose, relenting the stench of death inside his closed tomb. Martha and Mary are grieving, and while glad to see their friend Jesus, are unsure of how he can help at this point. After a heartfelt conversation with Jesus, Martha professes her belief in him as the Messiah, the Son of God, which seems like it might be the turning point of our story. Yet when they arrive at Lazarus' tomb, she voices sensible concerns about opening it and releasing the stench of death over the crowd, revealing that even she cannot conceive of what is about to happen. The power of God's love goes over and above what could be expected, hoped for, or even imagined to be possible. They remove the stone. Jesus calls Lazarus, and of course, Lazarus comes out. We are told that many who were with them at the tomb and witnessed this miracle believed in Jesus when they saw Lazarus alive once again, which is pretty much what you would expect. I mean, after all, healing the sick, giving sight to the blind, these are important and impressive, but there are other healers performing similar types of cures in those days. Bringing back someone from the dead, someone who is so dead he's already been buried, that is a miracle. And enough of one to make some people change their worldview, or at least be open to the possibility that Jesus was different from the other prophets and healers. That perhaps he really was the Messiah, and that perhaps listening to him, following him, might lead to something better, something more fulfilling and life-giving than their current reality. Interestingly, though, there were surprisingly little rejoicing reported at the raising of Lazarus. It would seem to me like coming back from the dead would be the occasion to throw a big banquet, both to celebrate Lazarus' new life and to say thank you to Jesus. It is the perfect happy ending. But actually, what happens next is quite different. Although some of those who were at the tomb choose to believe, others go and report Jesus to the authorities. From John 11, verses 46 through 53. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what he had done. So the chief priests and the Pharisees called a meeting of the council and said, "What are we to do? This man is performing many signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will come and destroy both our holy place and our nation." But one of them, Caiaphas, who was a high priest that year, said to them, "You know nothing at all. You do not understand that it is better for you to have one man die for the people than to have the whole nation destroyed." He did not say this on his own, but being a high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus was about to die for the nation, and not for the nation only, but to gather into one the dispersed children of God. So from that day on, they planned to put him to death. Here we see that the other reaction to Jesus and the miracle of raising Lazarus from the dead, while some choose to interpret this event as a sign of God's love for the world, and it inspired them to follow Jesus on a journey to grow in faith and their relationship to the divine. Others chose to interpret it as an overt threat to their power, provoking them to respond with the only way they knew how to maintain control, with violence. In addition to plotting to kill Jesus, they also plan to kill Lazarus once the word about him gets out. The story of Lazarus isn't just about the power of Jesus or the love of God, although it certainly demonstrates those themes. Importantly, it is also about how people react to those themes, how they choose to react to unexpected and perhaps undeserved good news, to the previously unthinkable becoming a reality, to the possibility of a power greater than they can control. This is the penultimate week of Lent, which is traditionally a time of introspection and soul searching. We have metaphorically been wandering in the wilderness, reflecting and considering our lives and the part we play in the lives of others. Hopefully, learning something about how we want to live our lives and grow in relationship with God. This year, we have the added challenge of physically keeping an appropriate social distance while battling the cabin fever of sheltering in place. Actually, being able to wander in the wilderness might sound rather attractive at the moment. In addition to the deep theological questions that we were prepared to wrestle with during Lent, each day we are faced with many new, little and big decisions. Should I eat this bowl of ice cream or a piece of fruit? Should I go for a walk or watch that next episode on Netflix? Should I risk infection and volunteer at a food pantry, a homeless shelter, going to the grocery store for an elderly neighbor, or choose to stay inside? Should I say what I think they need to hear, although it might hurt, or keep it to myself? I find that during this uniquely stressful time, I'm confronted with more choices than ever. And for many of them, it seems like there's really no great answer, or at least my first choice is unavailable. So I'm working on making the one choice that is always available, to breathe, consciously and slowly. And in doing so, give thanks for life, for being alive, and for the source of all life. Every day we wake up, we are given the gift of more life. A new day, filled with the opportunity to make new choices, leveraging the wisdom of our experiences and beliefs to adapt to whatever life presents that day. Predictable or unexpected, anticipated or surprising, wondrous, and maybe even miraculous. Let us give thanks to God for the miracle of life, for the life of Jesus, God's beloved, for our lives, and for the gift of this moment of being together in spirit and in love. What's next when the orders to shelter in place have been lifted and life returns to normal? How might this event change us as individuals, as a community, as a society? The choices are ours. I pray that we choose wisely, remembering that God loves us unconditionally and that God's love goes over and above what could be expected, hoped for, or even imagined to be possible. Amen. As I invite you to join me in our time of prayer, I would like to call your attention to the fact that there's an opportunity to submit prayer requests in the chat section, recognizing as you do that, those prayers are publicly viewable. If you would like to submit a prayer request that is more private, please visit our website. There's also a link to click to that in the bulletin that you hopefully were able to find online. Let us be in prayer. Gracious God, we offer thanks for this day and for the opportunity to be together in worship. May we be still and know that you are God. We offer you prayers of thanksgiving for life and all those things that make life good. In these early spring days, surrounded by nature's beauty, we offer gratitude for the abundance and fertility of the earth. The wonders of nature take us unaware and raise our hearts to you. Help us as we work to maintain the health and the beauty of the earth for generations to come. We pray for our friends and neighbors who are near to us physically and in our affections. We pray especially for those we have named before you, for Brendan, Nicole, Grace, Mandy, Eunice, Connie, Pat, Lisa, Robin, and Helen. And for those who have lost loved ones, including the families of Terry, Ted, and Maria. We pray too for our enemies whose behavior we reject, with whom you call us to be reconciled. In this time of COVID-19, we pray, dear God, that you will help us to be calm. When information comes from all sides, correct and not, help us to discern. When fear makes it hard to breathe and anxiety seems to be the order of the day, slow us down, God. Help us to reach out with our hearts when we can't touch with our hands. Help us to be socially connected when we have to be socially distant. Help us to love as perfectly as we can, knowing that perfect love casts out all fear. May we walk with those we feel that are alone. Help us, O God, that we might help each other. We pray for our healthcare providers, for those who are sick and those who are grieving, for all delivery people, grocery store clerks, bus and train personnel, for all who are affected all around the world. We pray for safety, for health, for wholeness. In the love of the Creator, in the name of the Healer, in the life of the Holy Spirit that is in all and with all, we now pray together the Lord's Prayer in the language and words that are most familiar and comforting to you. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
All right. Now is the time in our service where we offer a portion of our blessings back to God. You may feel anxious about the future, but today our trust in God's abundance needs to take firm footing in our hearts. There are many ways to give to Pilgrim, even when we cannot be together in the sanctuary. Please visit our website to explore the many options you have for online giving. I myself downloaded the Tithely app this week to my phone and made a donation to the One Great Hour of Sharing Fund. This is one of the 5 regular campaigns that the UCC conducts during the church year, and we are collecting the One Great Hour of Sharing donations today, as well as our regular tithes and pledges. Our lives periodically seem adrift, from the refuge of your unwavering love. Restore our hope and help us to find contentment in you so that we may offer these gifts as devoted brothers and sisters of Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen.
We've come to the time of announcements in our service, and although we may not be able to gather physically together as a body, there are still many activities that we can participate in as a community. I invite you to check out our website to stay abreast of all upcoming events, and in particular, there are a few things I would like to lift up to you today. The Housing Forward Shelter program that usually was taking place in various churches around the community was consolidated a few weeks ago and had been temporarily moved to the Oak Park Temple. Many thanks to them for generously sharing their building 24/7. Unfortunately, a Housing Forward staff member who had been working there was diagnosed with COVID-19, and all guests have had to be dispersed to other places for individual housing. As you might imagine, this has put quite a financial strain on Housing Forward, and any financial support you can provide in this time of emergency would be gratefully accepted. Please visit their website to make a donation, or you can mail them a check. Pilgrim will be providing the opportunity to keep vigil for an hour with Christ, as is our tradition, as we lead up to Easter Sunday. This will take place for 24 hours from 8 a.m. Saturday, April 11th, to 9 a.m. Easter morning. Please sign up for 1 hour to sit at home and sing or read or meditate or contemplate as we build up to Easter. You can find the link to the sign-up genus in the What's Happening at Pilgrim Weekly email or on the Easter Vigil event notice on our website. Immediately following worship today, you are all invited to join us for our second virtual coffee hour via Zoom. You'll find the instructions for joining this online event in our website, as well as in the What's Happening at Pilgrim Weekly email. And I thank you so much, everybody, for joining us today. We hope that you will join us again next week for online worship as we celebrate Palm Sunday and also celebrate Holy Communion. Please make sure that you have some bread and fruit of the vine with you as you sit down to sign on for worship so that we may all be able to partake of this Holy Sacrament.
We'd like to invite you to join us, please, in singing the hymn, I Love to Tell the Story. We will sing verses 1 and 4.
I love to tell.
We are a people loved by God. May we live as signs of this love. We are a people blessed with hope. May we live in the light of this hope. May the love of God, the grace of Christ, and the power of the Spirit strengthen our faith and keep us spiritually connected during this time of social distancing. Go in peace. Amen.
Thank you.